I have been very lucky in my life with mouthpieces. I know that right now, that has just made a lot of you hate me. Especially with bass clarinet. Since I was 13 years old, my teacher, John Ye, introduced me to a man named Everett Mattson in New Jersey, who unfortunately is no longer with us. But Everett Mattson was a fellow who made mouthpieces for all of the great New York and, you know, not just New York, but this country's top players. And there I was at 13 years old, about to ask this guy to make me a mouthpiece. What he did, incidentally, was that he took C-Star, Selmer C-Star mouthpieces, which is the stock that I've been using since I was 13. He would reface them with any number of unconventional tools, like he used popsicle sticks to measure. He had very special popsicle sticks that he had developed, one for each particular player, so he could model. You know, I could say to him, I would like a Ronnie Rubin mouthpiece or a Joe Allard mouthpiece, and he would get out their popsicle stick and he would measure them out. And it was amazing. It was amazing the kind of tools that he was able to come up with these fantastic mouthpieces. Now, like I say, you know, he's no longer with us. He's no longer making mouthpieces either. You do have other choices out there. I mean, and since I was 13, I would say that the market for mouthpiece refacers and makers has exploded to the point now where you could go down the street and probably find five people to make your mouthpiece for you. That said, I have a couple of preferences. And I want to talk generally about mouthpieces today. This is going to be kind of a long installment because I want to talk about what are you looking for in a mouthpiece. So going back, I would say that most of the people that I hear who play bass clarinet who are clarinetists will choose a mouthpiece that is too close for them. Close. What is close? The distance that a reed... For those of you who have already heard this, you can fast forward. For those of you who are new to mouthpiece physics, the reed, there are several different points at which the reed either touch or will touch the mouthpiece, and that is called the facing. It is the table of the mouthpiece from here all the way up through the rails and the tip. But that's where most of the people do their work. When they're working on mouthpieces, they'll just reface the mouthpiece. They'll make it a little bit more of an open tip. They'll, you know, they don't really go inside. That's where Everett Mattson was very different. He was, I would go in and watch him work on it. He'd be sitting there gouging out the inside of this mouthpiece. He would gouge out the sides of the rails. He would gouge out down underneath, which I'm sure a lot of mouthpiece, you know, makers and refacers do. But it was sort of frightening to me to watch him sit there and just put some energy into this file. Anyway, you don't want a mouthpiece, however, that is too close in the facing, because that, again, it will limit the amount of different tonal possibilities of the mouthpiece. You won't be able to play as loudly or as softly. You won't be able to play as openly. You won't be able to play as brightly or darkly. You basically will play however the mouthpiece will allow you to play. Now, I tend to go up way on the open side. I have a very open tip. I have a very open chamber. And as a result, I'm able to play really incredibly ugly, loud stuff. And I can also play very nicely and sweetly. And, you know, it just requires a little bit more control in your embouchure and the way you produce the sound on the instrument. So anyway, so I use a C-Star. I recommend that highly as a good stock mouthpiece. And then the two people that I would really recommend you check out, first is David McClune, and his website is McClune Mouthpieces or McClunemouthpiece.com. I put the link right up here. And he makes a model called the S2 bass clarinet mouthpiece. And there are two ways you can handle it. You can either buy a C-Star and mail it to him, or you can have him buy the C-Star for you. I don't think he charges really a premium for that. The S2 is, I think, ideal for most people because it is a little bit more open than the S1. And then, of course, you can always try mouthpieces out, and if you don't like it, you can send it back, et cetera, et cetera. The other person is Maury Bakun. He makes his own mouthpiece. I'm not exactly sure the kind of blank that he uses, but I've tried some of his mouthpieces that have been very, very good. So either of those two, I think you'll have good results. I think that David's mouthpiece is significantly less expensive than Maury's, but if money is no object, call Maury. Let's talk about mouthpieces in detail. So what I have here is I have several mouthpieces, and I'm going to play them for you. And then my expectation is I'll probably have to stop the video and come back at you with going to use a spectrum analyzer to show you the different sounds that are different between mouthpieces that are maybe more open, more closed. Obviously, no two mouthpieces are alike, but I think I would strongly recommend that you, again, try for one that gives you the most variations. So what am I going to start with? I'm going to start with my usual mouthpiece, so I'll be right back.